brains again.
One of our leading men. Thank you. First of all, welcome back to Austin.
Yes, indeed. I love Austin. Austin has been good to me. We go back to when I was like, I don't know, 15, 16, something like that. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, I did. Actually, when I was 19, I did Friday Night Lights here. So I am well acquainted with this town.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Tell me about casting your leading man.
He's the only black guy that Marvel didn't hire. So we just said,
Everybody else, and I was just.
I wish this was vodka.
That's me.
See, Alice walked in the room to do it, and it was like, "There's the course he wore." That's it. It was just as simple as that. It was.
Yeah. I'm with them.
I remember the first time we had a Skype meeting that we had. We talked about the project.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had a Skype meeting. I was in Memphis shooting another job. And then we had a Skype meeting. It was him and my Cuesta, our director, and also another one of our producers. And, you know, we just talked about it, went back and forth. And then by the time I was available to get back in L.A., we met in the room, we did the audition. And, Chuck sang my praises. And he was just like, oh, my God, you're the best actor I've ever seen in my life. And how do you do this? And, wow.
I said from the beginning that I'm now like Aldis's Iago.
Yeah. He cried. He cried when I did my performance. So, no, none of that happened.
All of us are.
Exactly, we are.
That's what you can be out of the
time. I'm kidding.
We're bragging. We're having a brag on Al this moment. So, by all means, contribute to it.
With Al before this type of thing, just to make sure that, just to find out what he's wearing. Yeah. And he doesn't. He always tells me the truth.
I tell you the truth. And then but he doesn't believe me.
I know. I always think he's bullshitting.
I said today I'm wearing my sneakers and my pajama pants.
That's exactly what you said.
And the last time I told him I was wearing a full-on suit with a little cowboy hat, and he was like, you really came with the hat. I said, yeah.
Tell me when you guys ran into each other, I'm assuming in the audition room, or maybe you're just like, no, we have to have Aldis, and then we don't care who else comes on with him, and you're available.
He got the job first.
Oh, man, so you're the anchor here.
They were like, we want to bring this guy on. His name is Kevin. I was like, I don't know. Like, what has he done?
Please, Mr. Hodge. Please, Mr. Hodge. Please, Mr. Hodge. Please, Mr. Hodge.
I was
picture and resume, Mr. Hodge.
Exactly. I was really excited to hear that he was coming on. I was like, hell yeah, this is awesome. And then I think the first time that we sat down was had dinner at Ostra in Boston.
In Boston, yeah. Right.
Yeah, yeah. And which I'm going back to that place, man. It's awesome.
Yeah,
yeah. But we had dinner. We just sat. We chopped it up and talked about kind of figuring out, you know, where we were with developing these characters and the characters' relationship through the season. And, you know, it was good.
You are a veteran of legal dramas, crime dramas, you know, one of the pioneering, like, butt-kicking women in the crime dramas on TV. So what, like, attracted you to this particular piece? What are you loving about City on a Hill?
Oh, my gosh. It's so real and honest and ugly, you know? And I'm not delivering legal dialogue or procedural technical stuff.
Sure.
You know, they're serving up some really challenging material. Which is a gift for me. It is such a joy to be doing this work. I feel like I'm doing the best work I've ever done, to be honest. It's very cinematic. It reminds me of like the films that were shot in the 70s, you know? And to call it a crime drama really
doesn't
cover it all. Have you seen it? I don't know if you've seen it, but...
I haven't gotten to see it yet.
Okay, wait till you see it. It's like nothing I've ever seen, to be honest. And every performance is so spot on. And Chuck really comes to it from a very personal point of view. And there are little bits of him and his family, people he's known in his life, in every one of these characters. And regardless of gender, regardless of their backgrounds, everybody is so real and supported and layered. And
like we said, you've worked a lot in the legal dramas, crime dramas, action. How are you seeing kind of the roles for women like evolving over time? Like, what opportunities are you seeing for yourself now that at the very beginning of your career, just like, that doesn't even exist for women?
TV's always been a pretty great place. And to be honest, TV is really getting you know, some of the best writers and actors at this point. So you're seeing such great material out there, and through TV and you know, entities like Netflix and Hulu and such, you know, you're reaching such a huge audience, and these are the projects that people want to do. Yeah. Look, in this show in particular, one thing I like about it is I've never seen these characters before. I've never seen a female character like mine. And here I am, if you look at it from the outside, this character is the wife of a very corrupt FBI guy, played by Kevin Bacon. And when you read this script and you see what happens to this woman, I love that Chuck has given voice to those who've never been listened to. And not just my character, just about every one of them, male or female, to be honest, because you're seeing some of the interior context and interior lives of these people, and how powerful they are, particularly the female characters, too. And characters that might normally be written off as just sort of, oh, the wife, or she's just married to that guy. Yeah. And then you see what's going on under the surface, and it's such a joy to perform it. So.